गुड इवनिंग इंडिया, दिस इज अमृतांशु वाजपेयी एंड आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू येट अगेन अनदर एक्साइटिंग सेशन ऑफ सिटीजन साइंस एस्ट्रोनॉमी प्रोजेक्ट्स दैट वी हैव बीन अंडरटेकिंग सिंस पास्ट 6 months और सो एंड इन द लीग ऑफ द डिफरेंट प्रोजेक्ट्स दैट वी हैव बीन अंडरटेकिंग टूडे on the similar lines, as we have seen yesterday, it was the vernal equinox session that was taken up by the esteemed guest Dr. N. Ratnashree, the director, Nehru Planetarium, New Delhi. So, continuing with the similar lines, today we are here to take a step forward and become more specific as far as the upcoming asteroid search campaign is concerned. We are really going to have a small discussion regarding the things that we have to follow regarding the friendship that we basically can make with this particular sort of this field of astronomy or so. And today we have a very esteemed guest in form of Shri Tushar Purohit ji, who shall be taking this session for the day that will be basically aimed at citizen science astronomy, as well as it will guide you to general basics of astrometry, the field of astronomy we basically be looking at. So first of all, I just would like to want you to take you to a small ride of the venture of astronomy. So every time, whenever you come, whenever you move to some sort of an astronomical endeavor, there are a few terms that you really shall always encounter. So those things we should really be proficient in, and those things we should be befriended with. हमारी उन सभी टर्म्स से, उन सभी टर्मिनोलॉजीज से दोस्ती होना बहुत ही ज़रूरी है. तो आज जो है, मैं आप सभी लोगों को उस एक छोटी सी दोस्ती की तरफ मैं लेकर के चलना चाहता हूं, और उम्मीद रखता हूं कि ये एक छोटा सा वॉक थ्रू जो मैंने तैयार किया है कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम्स का, दैट रियली शैल हेल्प यू आउट वाइल सॉर्टिंग आउट द थिंग्स. नाउ फर्स्ट दिस पर्टिकुलर स्क्रीन ऑफ माइन, there is a small spherical dome that you basically will be seeing. So what we shall be dealing with is the field of astrometry. Now before astrometry, before doing anything, what we require is, we require to know a few basics or the grammar of that particular field of stream in which we are going to venture upon. So today I shall basically be taking 10 to 12 minutes of yours to a ride of a grammar. But I assure you, don't worry, it will not be that sort of a grammar class that we really expect many a times. But I hope to make I shall make you enjoy the things as far as this grammar of astronomy is concerned. So first of all, whenever we deal with the subject of astronomy, there comes stars in our minds. There comes, what is the first picture that comes to your mind? Sun, moon, stars, Saptarishi, Orion. So these are the different pictures that basically come to all of our minds over the course of thought when the name astronomy comes. And what all? Telescope, binocular, and all the things. So today we are going to revisit those concepts. But mind you, instead of doing all these things with the telescope or with the help of the binoculars, we shall be taking the aid of computers or the laptops as part of the modern technology. So first of all, what basically is astronomy? As we all know, astro is a Greek word which means stars. So astronomy is the study of stars and with the positions. It means the study of the positions of the stars. As you all can see over the left portion of my screen, there is a globe type of a thing which I have maintained. But if you see it clearly, in the middle of the globe there is another globe. So you may feel what actually this basically depicts. So a globe within a globe, what is this? So what we are seeing right now is a celestial globe that we are basically seeing. As you see, it's a celestial sphere, and this celestial sphere is a milieu of the sky. I just would like you to imagine yourself at one point. This is our Mother Earth, and so just imagine that you are standing at one of the places on the Mother Earth, and there you are observing the sky. So how do you observe the sky? We observe the sky as it is in the form of a hemisphere. You just you just see what was the last time when you felt the sky was near to you. So you, when you go to the roof of your home or you go to the garden of your particular place where you are, and you see something like of an hemisphere bowl, that is your sky, and that we call in the terms of astronomy as celestial sphere. Now why I took this celestial sphere was because when we will be doing asteroid search campaign, when we do anything, even when you go with your telescope to observe, what we try to capture, if you take your DSLR camera out, and after taking your DSLR camera out, and when you try to photograph a thing, what you are actually photographing, what actually you are observing, what actually you are processing on your laptop, we are processing a part of this celestial sphere only. So we should be aware that what we are going for. So we are going to deal with a portion of a celestial sphere as far as the observations are concerned. Now, what this celestial sphere, or in this field of positional astronomy, what we are going to do, or in the field of astrometry, what we basically will be doing for an asteroid, we will be observing an object at a particular date, at a particular time, from a particular location on the Earth, and by using very simple class 9th or 10th spherical geometry. So this is basically what we are aiming at in the field of astronomy or astrometry, where time is important, where date is important, and where location is important. So what actually this celestial sphere is? So for example, you extend our Earth to the heavens, you extend our Earth till the skies. So what you will get is, you will get a celestial sphere. And what is important on the celestial sphere is, distances are not taken into consideration, only the angular separations are important. For example, if there is one star behind another star, or to make it more, you can say, more easy for you to understand, you just see sun and moon. We all know that sun is very far away from us in comparison to the moon. But how do we perceive the sky? We perceive the sky as if sun and moon, they are almost at equal distances. So on the hemisphere, at the edge of the sphere that we are seeing, the distances are not important, but the angular separations, the angles are highly significant. So even if one star is behind another star, or one star is by the, you can say, separated in huge terms in distances by another thing, same place, what we tend to do is, we provide them the same coordinate or the same location. So sun, moon, planets, stars, all the 88 constellations, they basically are the part of this celestial sphere. So here we shall be dealing with these type of the coordinate systems whenever we encounter with the field of astronomy. There are global coordinate systems, there are local coordinate systems, and then celestial coordinate systems are there. But before describing you about these coordinate systems, let me provide you with a little bit of insight into the motions of the Earth that we basically encounter. What type of motion that we observe as far as the Earth is concerned? There is a daily motion, which we call as a rotation of the Earth. There is an yearly motion, which we call as the revolution of the Earth. And yes, of course, there is a very, you can say, subtle, a long duration of a motion, say, which takes about 26,000 years or so in a rough pattern, that is the precessional motion of Earth, or the top-like motion. So here, we are not going to so much deal in detail with the third type of motion, because the platform really belongs to Tushar sir. So I shall be giving you a brief insight into the daily motion and the effects arising out of it, and the yearly motion and the effects arising out of it. So just imagine how the Earth is rotating. So Earth rotates, number one, it rotates from west to east. So naturally, what happens with the objects that we see? The objects, they tend to rise in the east, or they tend to move from east to west. So I shall just give you an analogy. Imagine you are sitting in a train and you are moving from one place to another place. If you are looking out from your window of the train, how will you see the other objects? The objects that you shall perceive, they shall be perceived apparently moving in the opposite direction as you are moving with. So the same analogy applies here. The Earth, it is rotating from west to east, so the objects automatically, they will tend to move from east to west. Or to be more precise, if we use the term of analogy, so what we do is they rise in the east, and while moving from the sky, they set in the west. So what happens is Earth moves 360 degrees, a complete rotation. In mathematics, what we know is one complete rotation means 360 degrees. So 360 degrees are moved in 24 hours. Correspondingly, dividing it by 24, what we get is 15 degree per hour movement of the Earth. So objects move 15 degree in 1 hour, or you can say Earth rotates 15 degree in 1 hour. This is a very important fact while the rotation is concerned. Now, secondly, this is what that apparent motion that I was talking about. It was the train analogy which I was giving you. Earth see the direction of the rotation of the Earth and see the apparent motion of the sky. So there is a rising side and the setting side. So the apparent motion of the sky is just opposite to the Earth's rotation. Now this is the second type of a motion that we really, really observe. And yes, but it's not observed on a day-to-day basis, but we tend to get a feel of the effects. And this is a very, very important motion, because in fact we all know it's the revolution of the Earth around the Sun. So revolution is when one object goes around another object. It's not simply Earth going around the Sun. Any object which goes around any other object, that certain sort of a motion is known as revolution. So stars rising and setting at different times all together, they are the effect of this motion of revolution. So what happens roughly in 365 days, the Earth moves 360 degrees. So if we make a little bit of an adjustment for the sake of understanding, so 360 degrees in 365 days, it means roughly 1 degree per day in a counterclockwise sense, the Earth is moving. I just wanted to show you that this is the rate at which the Earth is moving. So just remember, while rotating, Earth is rotating 15 degrees per hour. So, or in 24 hours, it is rotating 360 degrees. In revolution, Earth is rotating 360 degrees in 365 days. So, it is roughly 1 degree per day. So, we see different stars in different seasons as a result of this revolution only. So, in 1 hour, Earth is rotating 15 degrees. It means in 60 minutes, 15 degrees. So, in 1 degree, 1 degree is rotated in 4 minutes. So the direct answer that we can derive from this simple mathematics is stars, they tend to rise 4 minutes early every day. Now this is another concept that we should be aware of, the concept of latitude and longitude. And if we are aware of this concept of latitude and longitude, we really, really shall be able to understand the concept of the celestial coordinates. So latitude is the simple, as you may have studied in your books of geography, 0 degree latitude, take the middle figure, 0 degree latitude, the equator, then 10 degree, 20 degree, 30 degree, 40 degree, and towards the pole it is 90 degree. And if you come down, 10 degree south, 20 degree south, and intermediary latitude still 90 degrees. So these are the latitudes. As we move from equator to the north, in astronomical terms, positive latitude, and if we move from equator to the south, again it becomes a negative latitude. So these are the horizontal great circles, that is with the center of the Earth, the circles are drawn, and so these are the degrees of the latitude. And what actually a latitude is, the latitude is, that is this much, if this is the equator, so how much your place is at an angle from the equator, that basically is the latitude. And longitude, these are the vertical great circles which are drawn from your north pole to south pole, that is pole to pole, you draw a circle over the surface of the Earth. And what is the reference point for the latitude? The reference point is being taken as equator, but for the longitude, the reference point that I will say is due to pure political reason, the Greenwich Meridian Observatory is being taken as the reference. So if you are towards the east of England, you are in the positive longitude. If you are towards the west of England, you are in the negative longitude. And yes, as we all know, over this entire differentiation of the Earth, how much is the circle? It is 360 degrees. So 15 degree means 1 hour. So if you are, you can say our Earth, that is our India is 5 hours and 30 minutes ahead of the time of the England, that is 82 and a half degree meridian. So there are the different time zones on the basis of the longitudes that have been divided, but yes, the reference point has been arbitrary. So now this is the real portion which I really wanted to concentrate upon, and up till now whatever I have given you was only for the sake of understanding that what I am talking about. Just imagine you are standing in front of at any point where you can see the sky. Now you see just above, just at the point overhead. Now this point which is overhead, the topmost point that is present, it in astronomical terms it is known as zenith. Okay, now what I would request you is, now you just try to peep out to the bottommost point. You look at your legs and try to see at the bottommost point, the lowest point that is present as far as your references are seen, that will be the nadir. So if you imagine, if you extend this hemisphere that we are able to see, and had it been a complete sphere as it actually is, if you see from a third location, so then what you will be able to see is the topmost point is zenith and the bottommost point is known as the nadir. And if you connect, if you draw a line, I assure you, if you draw a line joining zenith and nadir, what you will get is, you shall get a line that shall pass through the center of the earth. And yes, this horizon, that is where this hemispherical dome, it meets the earth. That is, wherever you are able to see your hemisphere at certain distance, it shall descend down and it shall move, it shall meet the earth. That particular place is known as horizon. In Hindi, we call it as kshitij. Now, this is, you can say, a better representation of what the concept that basically I was talking about. So, this is our horizon. This is the topmost point for an observer. This is the bottommost point of an observer, the zenith, the nadir, and the horizon. Now, what I would just request you, if you remember, objects rise where? Because the earth is rotating from west to east. So, the objects rise in the east and they set in the west, because it's the opposite sense that we shall see. Now, if you, while traversing from east to west, what lies in between? In between, it will lie the two directions which we call as 90 degree. One is north and another one is south. So if you draw a circle from the north to the south, that is, you just open your imaginary pen in your mind and you see the north direction. And north direction is very easy to find, because you just have to locate your pole star, and from your pole star you just try to join the point that is just overhead to you, and then you make it extend to your south. That particular line is known as what we consider it as a very difficult concept. It is the very simple concept. It is the meridian. So if you try to draw a great circle from north via your zenith point to the south, what do you get is meridian. And if you are towards the east of your meridian, that time is known as anti-meridian. If an object is towards the west of the meridian, that is known as the post-meridian. So what really happens daily in the sky is, earth is rotating from west to east. You see the objects moving from east to west. So they rise in the east, they set in the west, they cross the meridian. That is, this process is known as transit. These are the different terminologies which every astronomer will talk about, which Tushar sir will also mention many times. So whatever the things that we are talking about, these are the basic terminologies that you should be aware of. So I hope that this concept of zenith, nadir, meridian and horizon is clear to you, and also the transit point. Now, what happens is, the objects, whatever objects that you are seeing, if you try to see towards the north of your sky and towards the pole star, and you try to point out a camera with a video opening, what will you shall see is, because our earth is rotating in that sense with respect to north, and if you open a video recording of the things, so what will, after if you close the recording, what you shall see is, you shall see the objects churning out a circular motion. These circles in which the objects, they basically move out, they are known as the diurnal circles in astronomical terms. So this is actually, if this is the north pole, this is the south pole, so this is the sense of the motion of the different type of the objects that you shall basically see. And these circles, they are known as diurnal circles. And if you draw an axis that is perpendicular to the diurnal circles, then what we shall get is, we shall get the north celestial pole and the south celestial pole. So now this is the basic, you can say, the photograph that we basically are always seeing. Then this shall make clear to you the concept of a diurnal circle also. So this is, as you are standing here as an observer, this is your north celestial pole, and here is the topmost point where you are saying north celestial pole means that is this is where you are able to see your pole star. So you have drawn a line from the north via your zenith to the south. This is your meridian. So here is your east and west. Now your object, particular object, is rising from this point. It is making a transit and it is setting down here. So this particular portion is known as a diurnal circle or an apparent path of the particular star. And these are the, that is, in this manner, if you try to arrange the things, the different type of protectors, if you are able to see, then you shall really be able to see the things move out. Now these are the coordinate systems which we should really be aware of. There are two types of ways in which we reference the objects in the sky. The first type of the referencing is the altitude and the azimuth system. Now zenith is, again I would like to reiterate, the straight point that is overhead us. Meridian, which is the line from north to south passing through the overhead, and north is the point on the horizon that is pointing towards the north pole. Now comes the all important thing, that is what basically this altitude and azimuth is. So first of all, I will just tell you what is the altitude. That is, altitude is nothing but how high a particular object is above the horizon. That is your altitude. And interestingly, if you see the pole star in your sky, and what you do is you take a protector out and you measure the that is how high your pole star is, what you will get is you will get the latitude of that place. So altitude is nothing but how high your object is your above your horizon. And then also there is another concept which is known as zenith distance. For example, if this is the where my pointer is, if you are able to see, an object lies here. So what will be the altitude? The altitude will be, if you take this much distance, that will be the altitude of your particular object. Then the zenith distance is this distance of the zenith from horizon. Actually this is the 90 degree angle. So zenith distance is 90 degree minus this altitude. So if somebody asks you the zenith distance or gives you something in terms of zenith distance, then you must remember zenith distance plus altitude is 90 degrees. So this is another concept of the altitude. Now comes the azimuth. So azimuth is nothing but what has happened? Okay. Yeah. So azimuth is nothing but it is a horizontal axis which is measured eastwards from the north. That is, if you start moving from the north towards the east, that is 90 degree measurement. Then if you want to go from north towards south, from north to south, that is because from north you can move in two different directions. Either you can go through west or you can go through east. Now here what we have to do is we have to go via east and while completing the circle. So if any point that falls in between north and east, it will be that much angle that you have moved with reference to north. So that will be the azimuth. If you are somewhere here between south and east, then you have to make the angle, you have to see the angle that you have traveled from north via east towards that particular position. So that will be the azimuth. So this is a very important thing which I just wanted to tell you. So number one is the altitude. Altitude is nothing but how high your particular object is in the sky, and azimuth is how much distance has been made in terms of angles when you have come to the location of that particular object from north via east to that particular point in the sky. So this is another reiteration of the same thing which I have just told. So if this is 60 degree, this is your altitude, this much is the altitude 60 degree, sorry, this much is the altitude 60 degree, this much is the zenith distance, and see, if this is, this object is here, so now how much distance that object has been traveling apart. So this object lies here, so you have to move from north to this much distance to this distance. So this much is your azimuth in terms of the altitude and azimuth. Now you take this north pole, you observe your pole star, and in your imagination you draw a 90 degree angle within the sky. What you get is you get the celestial equator. And this is actually what the celestial equator is. This is the equator of the earth when you extend up to the sky, to the limit of the dome that you have seen. So the same equator of the earth, when it is extrapolated in terms of the distances, then it becomes the celestial equator. And this angle of, that is the altitude of the pole star, is the latitude. So from pole star, you have to draw 90 degrees angle to get the celestial equator. Now if your pole star say is at 27 degree height, so your celestial equator will be shifted from zenith to the other direction by 27 degrees extra. So this is a very very important concept as far as the these things are concerned. You have to draw an angle of 90 degrees from the north pole to get the celestial equator at your particular place. Now this altitude and azimuth, they have got a problem. They vary from place to place and time to time, and they depend upon your local latitude and longitude, so they cannot be used as a standard. So this is a very, you can say, another view of the same concept of altitude and azimuth of a particular star. So you have to derive a system of standard celestial coordinates which is fixed in the sky, and it is independent of the observer's time and place. I am quickly browsing out through the slides, and this is a mathematical interpretation of the same thing which I have told you in terms of altitude and azimuth. And so here it comes, a very very important concept which I have told you. Now the earth is tilted on its axis actually by 23.5 degrees. So what happens to us is, what do we perceive? We perceive the orbit of the sun as tilted. If the earth has not been tilted, the sun would always had been on the celestial equator. At the equator, for the people at equator, they would have just always seen the sun overhead. At the other places, they would have seen at a fixed angle from the zenith. So there would not have been any change at all had the earth's axis would not have been tilted. Now from this point, another concept which is known as ecliptic, it comes into play. It is a greater circle which is tilted at 23.5 degrees to the celestial equator as far as the tilt of the earth is concerned. So what happens is, here we shall be using a concept of hour angle and declination. Now what is this form of declination? Now this declination is just, you can say, analogous to the what we call as the latitude on the surface of the earth. So declination is measured from one of the reference point that we have taken, and this reference point is the vernal equinox, and this is the symbol for the vernal equinox that recently happened yesterday. And so what we do is, we move from the vernal equinox to the north celestial pole. We are moving to the north celestial pole, and how much above the celestial equator a particular object is, how much above the celestial equator an object is, that is known as the declination. So it is analogous to the latitude on the earth. If you remember, on the latitude, how much above our equator we are, so that is the latitude of us. So in the similar manner, how much above a star is above the celestial equator, that is known as the declination. And so as we move on the celestial globe, we can move from 0 degree to 90 degree in the northern direction, similarly from 0 to 90 degree in the southern direction. So this solves out a simple problem, because this declination, it shall make it as an independent factor as far as the things are concerned. Now we shall require one more factor which should be very very much important as far as the computation is concerned. Now when we are going for the computation, what basically happens is, another concept of right ascension also comes into play. Now this right ascension is the point, we are again taking vernal equinox as the important form of reference. Now this vernal equinox is the point where the celestial equator and the ecliptic cut, if you remember this. So again, this is an arbitrary measurement that we have taken. So this vernal equinox is the point where the celestial equator and the ecliptic, they are cutting each other. So this is the cutting point of the equator and the ecliptic. So we can treat it in terms of a longitude. So how much far we have moved in terms of distance from that cutting point. So that is the right ascension of the things. So this is the declination, if you remember. So this declination is, that is how much up or down we are with reference to the celestial equator. And then this is the overall measurement, that is from the local meridian. So basically from the local meridian, how you have moved with reference to your particular place, as far as the spacing is being concerned. So this is the concept of the vernal equinox, that is the first point of the Aries constellation. So vernal equinox, here I am referring to the Aries. If you move from your vernal equinox over the celestial equator to that particular place on the celestial sphere. So that is the right ascension, and how high or how low you are moving from the celestial equator, that is declination. So this is the same as we on the earth we were seeing, if you remember, the altitude and the azimuth. So the altitude was also from the direction of the north via east towards that object. So the azimuth was from the north via east towards that particular object. So the analogy here is from the vernal equinox or from the Pisces constellation towards the particular object. And or you can say, to be more precise, if we can treat this declination in terms of the latitude, and we can treat the right ascension in terms of the longitude. So these are the different things which we always shall encounter while dealing with the astronomy. So we should be very much aware of the concept of zenith, nadir, horizon, or meridian, right ascension and declination, ecliptic and the celestial equator. So I hope that now the things have gone into little bit into your imagination. I know that I may have been a little bit out of touch for a few of people, but if you have any doubt, you can unmute yourself at the latter end of the part, and we can have a discussion if any doubt exists. So with these words, I take your leave, and I hand over the session to our second speaker of the day, our Honorable Tushar Purohit sir, who shall be taking up the things from here. So over to Tushar sir. Hello Tushar sir.
Hello.
Yes sir.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes sir, perfectly.
Okay, so thank you, Amritanshu. So we'll begin with the basic topic, which is related with our activity. So I will start. Participate or discuss about this citizen science in astronomy. We are observing. So the next thing we generally observe, okay, so the content of this topic is basically the observations. So observations we generally know. So twice a time we have get the opportunity of observing the eclipse. Then sometime we get a chance to observe the Mercury or transit of Mercury or Venus, and regular observations of meteor shower, variable stars, occultation, and these are the part of this citizen science. So what is this basically deals with? So the important thing is, now this is basically a double star or the binary star. We call it as a eclipsing binary. So what you will find, there are the two different stars. One is extremely big, one is a smaller. So big star has a brightness will be a more, and the smaller star has a brightness is a slightly lower. But what happened while they rotating, the brightness is combined of this. But when they cover each other like an eclipse, so the brightness of that particular star is dropped down. Once again, that will stable, and once again, when the smaller star comes in front of the bigger star, again it will drop down for a little. We call them as a variable star because the brightness is changing. And you can observe this variable star. And one of the beautiful variable star which is visible right now, the name is Algol, that lies in a constellation of Perseus. So you can see this Algol star, that is the eclipse in binary. And the period for this particular star is 2 days and 20 hours. So after 20 hours, 2 days and 20 hours, what happens? This particular star, it becomes a dimmed out for the next 5 hours. Again, the brightness increases. So we call them as a variable star. You can take this type of the observation and submit this observation to AABSO. That is the American Association of Variable Star Observation. But how to take this observation, you have to observe minute by minute and you have to record them. All right, once you record them and you can send this report to this particular organization which look after the variable staff. All right, so that is the one thing. So the next thing we generally observe, the most beautiful thing, that is the comet. So last year one of the comet is visited and it's visible at after the sunset, and you can able to see the tail of this particular comet. So while observing this comet, basically what happened, you can able to see the comet has two different type of the tail. One is the dust tail and one is the gas tail. Okay, the most important thing is our dust tail. So while moving around the sun, so what you can observe, the comet can come from the any side of the solar system. So you can observe this particular comet is moving in this orbit, and while moving continuously it is distributing a dust particle in that particular orbit. And whenever this dust particle are distributed in that particular orbit, what happened, while rotating Earth around the sun, sometime Earth enters this particular dust tube. And whenever that Earth enters in a dust tube, you can able to see the most beautiful thing, that is we call as a meteor shower. Okay, there are the different type of the meteor shower. This is the beautiful meteor shower visible in month of August. It generally comes around 11 or 12 August, so you can able to see. As I have mentioned that this is the constellation Perseus, where you can able to see, here is the Algol. So you can able to see the particular star, that is the Algol is also visible right now in the sky. And one more thing, that is the constellation or the meteor shower is known by the particular zodiac or the constellation. Why? So whenever you are observing, this is another beautiful meteor shower and extremely famous, that is a Leonid meteor shower. So while observing these meteors which are appearing all over the sky, and when you are observing, if you can observe this particular meteor shower, then if you can trace back the tail of this particular star, you will find they all are meeting at one point. We call that particular point as a radiant. And radiant lies in particular some constellation. So we generally name that particular meteor shower by that particular constellation. So that is Perseid, Geminids, Leonids, Quadrantid, and recently the next will come on 22nd April. That is the Lyrid meteor shower. That is close to the Vega star. Okay, the meteors will appear from the constellation Lyra. And if you wanted to find out this particular constellation, so keep in mind you have to observe this Vega. Once you get the Vega, the meteors will, you can observe it. Whenever you are observing this particular thing, so this is a nice picture taken by the person who is taking this picture for a long time. So you can see many more meteors are coming. But always keep in mind, the meteors are coming parallel. But our sky is appear to be a spherical
thing.
So that is why we can see in a different angles. Okay. And while observing this meteor shower, what you can see, this is the observation log which you can fill up. So I started observing at 9 o'clock and started measuring the different type of the meteors along with their brightness, that is the magnitude. And once you do this thing, then the next part at the morning, what you have to do, you have to do the data reduction. So whatever you have observed in the night, you have to make a tabular form to submit to your operation or observation. Okay, so this is the summary report of that particular observation. So this is a Leonid meteor shower which is observed, and you will find the meteor shower is distributed by 10 minutes gap, and what are the magnitude of that, and sometime you feel this doing this work, taking an observation, that is extremely nice, you can enjoy that thing, but taking or reducing a data, that is a difficult. Okay, so always you try to find out if there is any software or application where I can put this number and this software will do my the rest of the work. If you wanted to do the same thing every day, then it becomes completely boring. Taking the observation, extremely nice. But making a report, that is sometimes it's boring. Okay, so that is one of the thing. But when if you are taking this type of the observation, so the next observation is on a 22nd April. So try to observe this meteor shower. And for observing this meteor shower, you don't require any type of the single instrument. Only you require, you can observe through your eyes. Okay, so with the help of the eyes, you can going to observe this particular thing. So that is the most important. And once you observe this thing, you can just do the reporting. And the International Meteor Organization, that is the international organization where you can submit your data for the further analysis. All right, that is the one thing. So the next, we can only observe the things. So this we call it as the occultation. So what do you mean by the occultation? Occultation is the one type of the eclipse. But in eclipse, the sun and moon, both are the same size body. But in occultation, the size of the bodies are changing. One is a smaller, one is a bigger. And the bigger object is covering a smaller object. So here I am showing you the image of the Saturn's occultation. And this bigger thing, that is a moon. Always you will find the moon always rise 50 minutes late every day. So while moving in the sky, it always covering a few stars and sometimes of planets. Okay, so basically we call them as a planetary occultation, and these are the most beautiful phenomena to observe. So this is the one of the Jupiter and satellite. Here is another occultation of a Mars. Do you wanted to observe this particular phenomena? Yes, definitely. So the next phenomena is just nearby us. So the next phenomena will be visible on 17th April. The moon is going to occult a Mars. All right. So this is a beautiful phenomena which is visible from the India. So we call them as a twice a time. The moon, while moving a moon, it covers the particular object, that is a Mars now. So it will cover the Mars. So we call that a particular event as a disappearance of the Mars. And after some time, when the moon passes and it will reappear from the behind the moon, we call the reappearance of the particular object. So that is the visible from your small telescope or even with the small viewfinder. So try to observe this particular thing, and if you can do properly, if you can time it properly, then you can get many more things related with the objects. So that is the one type of the occultation. Okay, so these are the observations are very important. Okay, a same type of the thing as I have mentioned, the moon is covering a particular object, that is sometimes that is a star or the planets. But while observing, or the most important part related to our astronomy or the astrometry, we are doing the astrometry which is related with our asteroids. So while observing this particular asteroids, what happened? The asteroids are moving in the sky, but as size of the asteroid is very small. And if you compare the particular asteroid with magnitude level, the magnitude level is extremely high. It's around 14 to 16 magnitude. And whatever the stars you are observing with your eyes, that is the limiting magnitude, is at ideal condition, that is the 6 magnitude. But while observing through the telescope, you can observe 11 or 12 magnitude stars. Sometime while moving these particular objects in the sky, what happens? They cover the particular star for a fraction of seconds. While they're moving in the sky, they cover the star. So what happens? Slowly you will find that that particular star is disappeared for a fraction of second and reappeared. So what we can do, we have three different observatories which are observing this particular phenomena. And if you can time it properly, and you can do the most of the thing. This is the one of the beautiful observations were taken from the Karnataka, and we have a team at three different location. One is Londa, one is Sirsi, and one is Ganeshguri. So they are just a couple of almost 25 kilometers away from each other, and we observe this particular star. And while observing this particular star, when this asteroid is moving, sometime what you can see a diffraction pattern. And with because of this diffraction pattern, you can notice that particular, that is asteroid, is working as a knife edge. And whatever the stars is close or disappeared, what you can see, either that particular star is a single or double. And while doing this exercise in 2001, we observed this particular phenomena with the help of the CCD camera and the instrument. And we noticed that that star, instead of just disappearing, it's blinking. And this was the report we submitted. And what happened? Initially, that particular star was considered to be as a 8.2 magnitude. But when we observed and noticed that, then we found that that particular star was not a single, that was a double star. And one star is a 9.2 and the one is a 9.4. So this is the beautiful discovery is done while doing this particular occultation. And this is the path of that particular occultation, which is going from the Karnataka. And we observed the same thing, and a few observers from Egypt, they also noticed this particular thing. And that is why this new discovery were done. That particular star is not a single, that is a double star. And we have reported. Okay. So this type of the observations you are taking. All right. So initial days, so if you wanted to observe this particular event, you have to travel that particular location, take all the instrument along with you and adjust everything. If the weather is good, you can able to see that particular event. But nowadays we have so many network, so instead of going that particular location, what people suggest, if there are the amateur astronomers or who knows about a particular thing, they can easily observe the particular event and report it properly. So the same type of the thing we can do, and you can also become a part of the discoveries. Okay, so the next occultation, what I am just talking about, so this is the occultation of the Mars, which is visible from the India. So you will find slowly the Mars will disappear or go behind the moon, and slowly it will come back from the behind the moon. So you can able to see that particular phenomena. It's extremely nice to observe this thing. Okay, so when I'm talking about this particular thing, or the most important part, you are taking so many observations and you are submitting them. And if you can consider, okay, how many observatories in the world? If you can consider, there are almost more than 600 observatories which are working every night, taking observations and doing the process. So where this citizen science come? So basically the importance of the citizen science or the citizen scientists, it comes along with this. Okay, taking observation is perfectly fine. Reducing the data, that is a one more part. And after reducing the data and finding a particular event in that particular observation, that is also important. We can use so many computers, super computers, to calculate the mathematical things. All right, so whatever the data is collected. So now consider each and every observatory within a night, that is considered to be as 8 hours. Within the 8 hours, they are taking almost 1 trillion data every night. And how to reduce or how to sort out this particular data, that is the extremely difficult task, because you can write the program which will bifurcate your data in the different things. If you are taking the images, they can bifurcate that particular images along with the help of the software. That is the one type. But whatever the you can observe, if you are observing a galaxy or something else, then the computer doesn't understand what a special thing which are appearing in your photograph. So that is why we require so many people who can participate and do this data reduction work. And here is the most important part of our comes, that we can become a participate in a different campaigns and become a citizen scientist. Okay, you also get the credit for doing this work. Okay, so while doing this thing, so whatever the observations nowadays, initially we just take out the telescope and observe through our eyes. That was the old fashion. Nowadays, instead of observing with our eyes, now we are doing a digital eyes. So that is, we call it as a one camera, that is a CCD and CMOS. So what is the difference between these two cameras? Okay, CCD is a charge coupled device and CMOS is a complementary metal oxide semiconductor. Alright, so where I can see this type of a thing? So each and every person is using a mobile, and with the mobile, each and every person has a different camera. All this camera has a sensor which collect the light or the images. That particular images or the light is collected by the CMOS. Okay, for the particularly for observing details of the sky, instead of using a CMOS, we generally use a CCD camera. So what is the CCD camera? So basically you can see a difference between the CCD camera and this CMOS. So you will find when we talk about 1 megapixel, 2 megapixel, 3 megapixel, what is this? That is this particular square that we call it as a megapixel. Okay, in each square, what you will find, there are the one is a red, one is a blue, and two green color sensor. So that is a 1 pixel. Okay, that is the basically idea of CMOS sensor. But in CCD camera, what happened? Each pixel has a different things, and they can calculate, or we can use that particular that sequence or the square, we call it as a value. Okay, and whatever the lights is collected that particular value, we can observe it. So this is a CCD camera which is attached to the telescope, and when we are attaching this particular camera, we can able to see the most of the beautiful photographs taken by this particular cameras. So the most of the photographs what we observe on the internet, that is all is taken by this camera, that is the CCD. And basically the most important in the CCD, we can check out each and every square. Okay, every time whenever you are taking the images. Okay, so here, these these are the basically raindrops. But that is not a raindrop. That is the light. That is the part is the photon. So photon is coming from the sky, and we are collecting in a buckets. And so whatever we are collecting in a buckets, we can just go to each and every bucket, and we can calculate how many photons were collected by that bucket. And with the that number, we can calculate what is the magnitude of that particular star or planet or any object. Okay, so that is the idea behind the CCD camera. That facility is not possible in a CMOS sensor. Okay, so basically the most of the time with our astrometry, the Isaac Newton telescope, which is in La Palma, is basically taking a wide field photography and providing us a different type of the photos to observe or making a data reduction. All right, and while doing this thing, the image comes with the CCD, so you can able to see this is the image taken by the CCD. So everywhere there are the stars, but while doing this particular thing, the CCD is also a charge coupled device, so the charge is already there. So because of this charge or the electronics, we get some noise in between, and that noise is also calculated in our photos. So that is why we can take a different type of the image sets. Okay, if you are taking a particularly one single image, along with that particular single image, you can take one dark image, one black image, and one is a bias. And after reducing this particular images, then the next final output comes, that is a purely scientific astronomical image, which generally provided by the observatory to us to analyze that particular location. And there is another concept, or there are the observatory which are regularly taking images of the sky and bifurcating all the stars or mapping the stars. We call them as a all sky survey camera or the observatories, and which is doing a regular thing. So they can observe this particular sky every day, and they are matching all the things. So whatever the stars we are observing, so we can just go to a DS9 is one of the beautiful software which is open source, which generally you can put your image in this particular software and just go through the run, and after calculation you will get each and every star has a different array and day. As Amrutanshu mentioned about what is the array and day, that is a coordinate system for our sky. So that is the one type of the thing we generally use then, and we can find out this particular observations. Okay, and after the scientific image comes, we can just go to particular stars and click it. So they will give you a one beautiful curve, that is a magnitude curve. Okay, so we can get a different type of the facilities related to the when a scientific image comes back. So while doing the astrometry thing, we'll get the set of this particular images, and where we have to find out on different things. So you can, if I can just go through that particular software or DS9, I can get each and every dots as a different array and day. But there are the asteroids, so they are moving. So you have to find out that particular asteroid which are moving in this particular area. So that is our task, and that task we have to complete. And once you do it properly, you will become the citizen science, and you can contribute this particular data to the astrometry with the help of this thing. So there is one more thing. This is called the zoo universe. Zoo is where you can just go and observe the different type of the animals. Same thing, this is the zoo of the universe. So here you can see whatever the things we are discussing about are different observations. So here you will find the sun, then the different type of the pulsars, then there are the different type of the nebulae, galaxy and meteors, everything is there. So whatever you have interest, you can just enter that particular area and you can train yourself to how to reduce the data. And that is basically our citizen science is come. While doing this related to the sun, if you are observing related with the sun, so there is a telescope or the satellite which is in a space. The name is SOHO, that is operated by the NASA. And that particular satellite is continuously observing a sun by doing an artificial eclipse. So in this image you will find the sun disk is covered, and that is observing a corona. And sometime when we are observing this particular asteroids or the comets, and but if that is a big enough or a bright, then we can able to see them with our telescope. If they are extremely faint, then it's hardly difficult to notice them. But sometime when they go closer to the sun, we can able to find out this particular thing. And a few peoples who are contributing with this such type of the phenomena, they has discovered this type of the comets. So just a college going student, they can also participate in this particular thing. And one of the person has almost discovered a 33 comets with this data reduction. Then the next thing is related with aurora borealis, or this is a phenomena which is visible from the pole, that is northern and southern pole, that is because of the solar wind. So you can contribute or do the exercise in this particular thing. The next thing comes with a planetary thing. So planetary observation is also one of the thing where the most of our satellites are moving in the sky, and also the NASA sends different satellites. Right now the one of the mission is just went to the Mars, and they are doing a rover observations, a same type of the things. But all these things required experts who knows about astronomy and little bit, and they can dedicate a few time to observe this particular things. Then the next thing is about this planet hunting. So right now we know more than 1,000 stars which is having a different type of the solar system, not like us, but something a difference. Some of the planets are bigger than the Jupiter, so we are searching this planet where we can find out a Earth-like planet which is possible. So that type of the extra or the exoplanetary system, we can also participate in this particular campaign. And the next thing is related with our thing. So that is the one type of the all-sky camera, and there while you can do, that is the one target is observing an asteroid. Okay, so sometimes this asteroid changes their path due to the gravity of the Jupiter, because of that the path or the orbit is changed, and they can suddenly comes to the closer to the sun, and while coming to closer to the sun, they can directly crash with this Earth. So that probability is there. So there is a survey, that is a near Earth objects, that is a one of the survey is also regularly done. Not only that, we can also observe this asteroid. The one thing is the most important thing, that is our this astrometry. So international can, where we are taking the images, we are observing them, and we can find out a different type of the asteroids, which is probably we can get a different discoveries for that. So this is the basic idea where always you consider ki if you wanted to become a scientist, you have to do the studies, this, and then after that, after doing a degree, MS, and postdoc, and doing this thing, you can become a scientist. But not like that, but you can also contribute in this particular database, reduce that, and you also contribute internationally for this particular thing. So that is why we call this particular people as a citizen science. So they are dedicatedly observing this particular thing and doing or the reducing a data for the next things or the observations. So thank you. If you have a questions, we can definitely go.
Thanks a lot, Tushar sir. Yeah, thanks a lot, Tushar sir, for sparing your valuable time and guiding out the fellow members. Sir, there is a question in the chat box, and there are a couple of questions in my inbox also. So, in the chat box, Sir Chitiz has asked, "What is the difference between conjunction, transit, and occultation?"
Conjunction is basically the two objects comes or the appears to becomes to be a closer. Okay, so in a December month of the December, we observe the conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn. They appear to be coming up close, but compared to the distance between both of the planets is a different. So they are not coming actually close, that is appearing as to be up close. So that is the conjunction. Occultation or the transit or the eclipse, that is the, all are the same phenomenon. But there is a difference. What is the difference in eclipse? The sun or moon, both are angular size, almost same. But when we talk about occultation, the occultation, one of the objects angular size is bigger and the other object is smaller. So bigger object is covering a smaller object, we call that particular phenomena or the eclipse as a occultation. And when the a smaller objects covering a bigger objects, we call it as a transit. So that is visible in Mercury transit or Venus transit.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. And Chetij, to make it more astronomically, that is, if the two objects, they get near on the same ecliptic longitude or they have the same right ascension, which I just told in the beginning, then also in astronomical terms, it will be conjunction. Sir, Shubham has asked, is it possible that our universe is a computer simulation?
So basically the thing is, keep in mind, so whatever the things we are observing or the most of the telescope or the satellites we are keeping in a space, they are regularly observing so many things, taking a data. And with the help of this data, we do a different type of the modeling for this particular thing. Okay, so with the help of this modeling of the universe, we can get the idea what are the things are actually is going in a universe. Basically, sometimes you have to imagine, because you cannot go and observe that particular thing. So sometimes you have to imagine, you can do the theoretical work and do this thing. But that is not a actually original thing. That is, universe is not a digital thing.
Thank you, sir. And actually now there is a question in my inbox which has come over, that is, I had shown actually one of the slides in which hour angle was there and I did not explain to it. So dear friends, hour angle is nothing. It just will tell you whether the object is on the meridian, if the object, that is, how far that particular object is on that particular part of that portion of that meridian. So that is regarding that of that hour angle. If your object is on the meridian, then the hour angle is zero. If the object is towards the east of the meridian, then it is between 0 to 6 and positive hour angle. And if it is towards the west of your meridian, then it will be negative. So hour angle is nothing. In simplest terms, it is, you have drawn your line of meridian from north to south, north celestial pole to the south celestial pole, through your passing through your zenith, and over that meridian line, how much far your particular object is on your meridian. For example, this is your observer's meridian, and with reference to this observer's meridian, if it is object is still towards the east, so then that will be another hour angle. Now it basically have the measures from 0 to 6, and each hour means 15 degrees. So if we try to convert it, then there is a lot of possibilities are there. And yes, hour angle and declination, they together combined also, they become a form of a coordinate system. But again, the problem with the hour angle is same. Hour angle, just like the altitude and azimuth, it basically gives the same problem. It will depend upon your observer's longitude. So it is also not a standardized, you can say fully standardized formation as far as the things are concerned. For that, personally speaking, the most standard and the set format of the measurement is this right ascension and declination. So right ascension, again, it is an analogous of the longitude, and declination is the analogous of the latitude. So it is measured how north, again I would like to reiterate, declination is how north or towards the south of the celestial equator you are. And our this right ascension, again, is it is the, if the zero point, if you remember, the zero point for our longitude is that Greenwich meridian time. Similarly, the zero of our right ascension is the vernal equinox point in the sky, and that is on the celestial equator, location on the celestial equator of the sunrise on the first day of the spring. So how far you are from that point of the vernal equinox, that is your right ascension. So I hope that now the things have gone clear regarding the hour angle.
Yeah, Amrita, shall I add something?
Yes sir, sure sir.
Yeah, basically hour angle is basically the difference between the zenith and particular object. Okay, that's so simple. So there is a difference between, if you are considering any object, or particularly the objects which you have to observe, and the what is the difference between the zenith and that particular object. So that different angular difference, that we call it as hour angle.
Sure, sir. Now again, sir, Shubham is asking why we mostly see binary star in this universe, but our sun is in binary pair with any other star.
Yeah, basically what happened, whenever the star formation takes place, that generally comes in a multiple stars. So if you can observe the few beautiful stars, it's like Castor is there, or Sirius, which is extremely bright visible, or the brightest star which is visible, they generally comes in a multiple thing. But in our solar system, fortunately, we have a four gas giant. Okay, one is Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. These are the are distributed. So the most of the mass or the gas is distributed in these four planets. So that is why we don't have this binary system. If there is a binary system, we cannot survive.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. And so there is one more question by Chitij. That is, he wants to know, sir, is there any citizen scientist program regarding the gravitational wave and its studies, like detection and all the things, right now, currently?
Not currently is yet decided, or any activities related with this gravitational waves. Okay, it's or the particular area has just come up, but mostly in a future you will get this opportunity, or the you can participate in this particular thing. The gravitational waves observatory is coming to India. So once that will start working, the most data will be collected. So that time we can get this or participate in this particular thing.
Sure. So sir, there is again a follow-up question from B. Srinivas sir. But before I take up that question, I have shared my screen for all the participants who are here. जितने भी हमारे मित्र यहाँ पर हैं, तो उनके लिए एक मेरा निवेदन है कि नाउ द नेक्स्ट सेशन विल पर्टिकुलरली बेसिकली डील एग्जैक्टली विद द एस्टेरॉयड सर्च कैंपेन. वी हैव मूव्ड फ्रॉम द स्पेसिफिक दैट इज़ फ्रॉम ए जनरल लेक्चर दैट वॉज गिवन बाय रत्नाश्री मैम टू सिटीजन साइंस बाय तुषार सर, एंड देन इट विल मूव टूवर्ड्स द स्पेसिफिक प्रोग्राम ऑफ द IASC. सो आई वुड जस्ट रिक्वेस्ट ऑल द ओल्ड मेंबर्स हु आर हियर एज वेल एज द न्यू मेंबर्स हु हैव ज्वाइंड टू काइंडली गूगल इट एंड गो टू दिस IASC.cosmosearch.org. काइंडली नोट इट डाउन, take the screenshot, whatever mode you are using. International Astronomical Search Collaboration, iasc.cosmosearch.org. And when you go to this website, what I would request you is, kindly go to this third option. You explore this website. This will be the friend of us while we are going to be a part of the asteroid search campaign. You go to this Astrometrica tab. Then you click over it. When you click over this Astrometrica tab, you browse down over it, you shall see this Astrometrica setup. So here you have to click over this Astrometrica setup, and I assure you it will not take much time because it is only 7 to 8 megabytes as far as the size is concerned. So my humble request is, go to this International Astronomical Search Cosmosearch.org, go to this Astrometrica tab, download this Astrometrica tab and install it. And after installation, what will happen is, by default, an icon will be generated over your desktop. And also, a same icon will be generated, same type of one folder of Astrometrica will be generated in your systems also, especially in wherever your Windows is saved. Say if Windows is in the C drive, an Astrometrica folder will automatically come up in the C drive of your particular system. So the first thing which I would request you is, after running up the setup of after downloading the setup of Astrometrica, you install it and run this Astrometrica for the first time from your desktop icon. Don't go to any shortcut that is being produced correspondingly in your C drive or D drive, whichever the Windows is. So mera aapse request ye hai sabhi doston se, mitron se, ki iasc.cosmosearch.org ki website pe aap jaye, aur jahan pe wo sathi जो कि आपको एक महीने तक आपकी नाव को, सिटीजन साइंस की नाव को किनारे लगाने वाला है, अब आप उसको डाउनलोड करें, उसके लिए आपको आईएससी की साइट पर जाकर के एस्ट्रोमेट्रिका पे स्टैप पे क्लिक करना होगा, और नीचे आने पर आपको एस्ट्रोमेट्रिका सेटअप मिलेगा। वो 7 MB या 8 MB का आपको सेटअप होगा और ये विंडोज़ में आएगा। आप जब इसको डाउनलोड करेंगे तो इसको रन कीजिए, कोई वार्निंग कंप्यूटर दे उसको इग्नोर कर दीजिए, और उसके बाद जो है आप इसको रन करने के बाद एक ब्लैक स्क्रीन कुछ आपके में जनरेट होगी और आपको फिर से पूरा जो है सेटअप रिस्टार्ट करना होगा, और सब होने के बाद एक आइकॉन आपके डेस्कटॉप पर अपीयर करेगा। उस डेस्कटॉप आइकॉन से आप अपने एस्ट्रोमेट्रिका सेटअप को अवश्य रन कीजिए। तो ये इट इज़ द नेसेसिटी ऑफ द डे। और इसके साथ साथ हमको एक और चीज़ की आवश्यकता होगी, बिकॉज लर्निंग फ्रॉम द पास्ट मिस्टेक विच आई डिड नॉट टेल इन द बिगिनिंग, सो दिस इज वन मोर थिंग दैट विल बी रिक्वायर्ड, इज वी रिक्वायर एन अनजिपिंग सॉफ्टवेयर। जो हमको जो फाइल्स एस्ट्रोमेट्रिका की जानिब से मिलती हैं, आईएससी हमको जो फाइल्स देता है हमारे अकाउंट पे, ऑल दोज फाइल्स दे आर इन द जिप फॉर्मेट। सो आइदर वी विल रिक्वायर ए विन रार सॉफ्टवेयर और विन जिप सॉफ्टवेयर और वाट एवर सॉफ्टवेयर दैट यू आर यूजिंग इन unzip format, because the problem is the data you get, the data is in the zip format, but what happens is Astrometrica does not take the zip file, it will accept only the unzipped files. So you will require Astrometrica setup from this website plus all the things. And don't worry about registration and all the things, we shall take care of the registration when all the things are being taken care of. So first of all, my humble request is, before 27th of March, I would request you to kindly download this setup and make it ready running, because if any problem comes, kindly inform me or Tushar sir or Sovan Acharya sir, we shall take care of the things. So now this was the thing which basically I just wanted to inform you. So be ready with the downloaded Astrometrica setup. Now I would just like to put up one final question by Srinivas sir. Srinivas sir has taken up this basic question, that what are the benefits for the citizen scientists in different programs other than IASC? Tushar sir. Yes, sir. Sir, what are the benefits for the citizen scientists in different programs?
Basically, that is giving you the pleasure. Okay, and you are just contributing the most important thing. So, whenever the observations were taken, okay, and the papers were published, you also get the credit for that particular thing. So, as a part of this thing, you can get the credit. Otherwise, it's just a fun. But if you contribute properly and dedicatedly, so you get the credit for that particular things. That is the most important, and that will remain as it is.
Okay, yes sir. So if anybody is having any other query, then he can kindly put it up in the chat box, or you can unmute yourself and you can ask the query. So I suppose the things have been clear, and thanks a lot Tushar sir again and again for joining the talk for the day and sparing your important, all important time with us. And if any parting note or wishes that you would like to give to the people who are joining the Asteroid Search campaign, sir.
So all the best for the all the people. Just do a properly work and do it very dedicatedly. Also, Amritansha, I will share the one of the PDF file, which is related as a tutorial for this asteroid camp. It's a basic thing which the most of the people will require, a short form and this thing. So I will share with the groups or the along with you.
Sure,
you
sir.
Think about it.
Sure,
okay.
Sir. Sure. Thank you, sir.
All right.
Thanks a lot. Thanks all the members. And the flow of the things that will be like this, I expect you all to kindly download the setup which I have just guided you all on that particular form. Friends, I hope that today we went for a small cosmic ride on the horizon of citizen science, courtesy to Tushar sir. Thanks Tushar sir. And there was a small explanation which I tried to give you, because there are people from different backgrounds who are joining us. They may not be proficient with the astronomical terms. So I know that there are a few difficulties of virtual sessions. We can't make you imagine by making you stand up and all those things. But if any problem comes in whatever concept that we have discussed, whether it is right ascension, declination, hour angle, altitude, azimuth, feel free to put it in the group. And we will give proper animation or whatever format in which your query will be satisfied. With these parting words, I thank all the audience, and I thanks the expert for the day, and also the observer, our Mukesh Satankar sir, for sparing his valuable time and joining the meeting for the day. With this, I call it the end of the meeting. Thank you. See you together all on 27th of March, Saturday. Note the date, and the timing shall be presented later on.
Thank you.
Thank you.